How many days did you have to familiarize yourself with the Titanic between the time you arrived and the time that you left Southampton?
About 3 days.
Was that enough?
Well, you couldn't. You wanted a week to go all round the Titanic.
Did you have any lifeboat drill?
We had no lifeboat drills. Lifeboats were things that they weren't necessary. You see, we were on a ship that was unsinkable. A couple of tenders came out with passengers and mail. And weather was perfect, absolutely calm, and we were flat out. You could smell ice. I knew it, because you can smell it.
What do you mean?
Keenness, a keenness in the air. There's something about ice that you can smell. I was talking to a pal of mine. He was sitting on my bunk. All of a sudden, she came to a halt. There was no fuss. It was like putting your brakes on a car, and you gradually came to a halt. And I went forward on the promenade deck, and I looked down. I couldn't see any damage at all above the waterline. What I did see was ice in the well deck, the forward well deck. And I thought, hello. We've hit an iceberg. By then, the captain had ordered out lifeboats and women and children. Lower the lifeboats and stand by. That was the order. Stand by.
This is only a precautionary measure.
The drop from...
The boats are perfectly safe.
The boat deck to the water was about between 70 and 80 feet. And you could hardly see the water, and people didn't want to go.
I'd rather not.
They got in their minds she was unsinkable.
I was thrown in. I mean, you know, he just picked me up and threw me in.
My room.
Sit down! She's the last.
She was gradually taken in the water, and she was gradually listing over to port. Then I thought, well, I don't know, there's something very serious now.
I looked up as the boat went down the side. It's a terribly long way down to that dark sea. I remember looking up and seeing him leaning over, saying, "Be good, look after Mummy." And that's the last I saw it.
We rowed out. I don't know how far it was, but it was beautiful, just a beautiful sight. It was, all the lights were on in the Titanic, and it was listing just a little bit in the front, you know, going down. But it was a beautiful sight.
So sad to have to take the wives away from their husbands and leave the husbands up on deck. And I knew that she was sinking then. And I knew what chances we were just waiting for death.
The decks were lined with people, not getting off. They were lined with people looking over the railing.
I remember looking over the rail and seeing a fully lighted ship. It was by.
I mean, I saw that ship. It's terribly close. And the other thing I'm saying is that I didn't see a ship 19 miles away. I saw a ship that was so close. And they said at the time it was less than 9 miles away. Now they're trying to say it was 19. I saw it, you know, it wasn't just lights on the horizon. You could see it was a ship. And I saw our rockets being fired, which that ship must have seen.
I've always said that I saw a man walking on the deck, and I did. They claim I didn't, but I was extremely farsighted. As a matter of fact, I had defective eyesight, and I was too farsighted.
They played one version of the hymn, Nearer My God to Thee, of which there are three. I've had this out so many times. And the one they played was the one that was played in church some months after when I was with my grandmother, and I was so frightened I came out of church, I ran out, I knew the tune so well.
I said to my father, see that lighter, that ship is coming to our rescue. Hardly said the words when the light was turned off and left us in the dark.
She gradually sank by the head, and you could feel everything going through her. Rumble, rumble, everything movable was going down.
They had two boards on the stern of the Titanic, which said, keep clear of propeller blades. And I was on the port one, hanging on. So much debris floating, and bodies dead and alive were all around there. So there were hundreds of them around the stern of that ship. They'd all seemed to drift down that way. And eventually I slid off. And I had a life jacket on, and I hit the water with a crash. But I didn't hit anything in the water. I was lucky, very lucky.
Then when the water rushed into the boilers, there was a terrible explosion. And that's when I thought the boat broke in half. And that's when the people started jumping into the water and screaming. That's when they screamed. It was terrible.
And I didn't close my eyes at all. I saw that ship sink. And I saw that ship break in half.
She came out of the water, up like that, and then she went flat down into the sea.
And the forepart went down nose first, and the other, the stern of that ship stood up in the water for quite a long time, or it seemed a long time to me, and then keeled over.
She went down and she came up. She was almost vertical out in the water.
Oh, freezing. That's what killed everybody. They didn't last long. They didn't last long. Anyway, when I found Ricks and he'd hurt himself, he'd hurt his legs, he dropped on something. And he didn't say very much, he was a great big fella too. Very good swimmer. And he died. And I was eventually, I seemed to be all by myself. The cries, help and prayers had all subsided and everything was quiet. And people, some of them, didn't leave their cabins even. And they must have died in their cabin. And they must have suffered more than I did, that much. Gradually dying.